Good afternoon, Niamh. Good afternoon. Not a good start. Good afternoon. Is that coming through? No. There we go. That sounds better. Good afternoon for a third time. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. Just remind members that questions 2 and 5 are grouped together. I'll take any supplementaries on those after both questions have been answered. We are tight for time across the afternoon, so the appeal for brevity in questions and responses. No, it's gone again. Is that any better? It's come back again. This is not an auspicious start. There is a grouping in this portfolio, 2 and 5. I'll take supplementaries on those after both have been answered. And again, the usual appeal for brevity in questions and responses. And I call question number 1, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it's supporting the arts sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As announced on the 17th of October, the Scottish Government's investment in arts and culture will increase so that in 5 years our investment will be £100 million higher than it is now. The Scottish Government will take decisions about the allocation of this funding in the 2024-25 and future years, subject to the outcome of the Scottish Budget process and associated approval by the Scottish Parliament.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. In the SNP's 2021 manifesto, it pledged to create a £2 million fund for public artwork. Back in the summer, questions were raised regarding the distribution of these funds, with the Scottish Government being unable to confirm at that stage a timeframe. Months have passed now, so can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to give more detail of what the pledge means and when the commitment will be met?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Alexander Stewart is working very hard to get me to give him a sneak preview of the budget process, which unfortunately I can't do. Draft budget will be published later. It will be subject to parliamentary scrutiny and will be presented to Parliament on Tuesday the 19th of December this year. That will be a date that will be in Mr. Stewart's diary, no doubt, being only a few days after he performs with the Scottish Parliament choir.
And supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The future of Edinburgh Deaf Festival is at threat following the rejection of 2 successive bids for Creative Scotland funding. The festival has been highly praised for its success in showcasing deaf performers' art, culture and heritage in addition to Edinburgh's festival fringe. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Scottish Government plans to encourage both BSL and deaf communities in the culture and art sector in Scotland to ensure our vast cultural landscape is inclusive and accessible to all?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, firstly, can I take the opportunity to thank Faisal Chowdhury for this question and for putting on record the points that he makes about sign language, the use of sign language. He'll appreciate that in terms of Creative Scotland funding, that's something for Creative Scotland to answer in terms of funds that are provided for. I'll be more than happy to write to Faisal Chowdhury more generally about the issue of involving sign language and the support for the deaf community in Scotland.
Question 2, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the impact of its funding for humanitarian aid to Palestine.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are gravely concerned by the resumption of hostilities over the weekend and reiterate our call for an immediate and permanent ceasefire, the release of all hostages and for unfettered access for humanitarian aid for all civilians throughout the Gaza Strip. In October, the Scottish Government acted quickly to commit £500,000 in response to the UN's flash appeal for Gaza, and last month we pledged a further £250,000 contribution to that appeal. These funds will be used to respond to the immediate food, health, shelter and protection needs of people seeking safety in UN shelters, with special consideration for the needs of particularly vulnerable groups, including women, children, peoples with disability and elderly.
Marie McNair.
While the support for humanitarian aid is very welcome, what is essential to save the many children and innocent civilians being killed is an immediate ceasefire. Medical aid for Palestinians say the bombardment is making it impossible to sustain human life in Gaza, and they call on our political leaders to heed the call from 36 human rights experts and take action to prevent genocide against the Palestinian people. Does the Minister agree with me that Rishi Sunak and Keir Starmer need to stop prevaricating and demand an immediate ceasefire to bring an end to this massacre?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, in a letter to the Prime Minister and Leader of the Opposition on the 21st of November asking for the UK Government to support a ceasefire on both sides, the First Minister wrote, "The support the UK Government has given to Israel while the devastation in Gaza has grown increases the moral responsibility on it to use whatever influence it has to stop the killing now." We again urge both leaders to join the UN Secretary-General and others in the international community in calling for an immediate and permanent ceasefire on both sides to stop the killing of innocent men, women and children and for unimpeded access for humanitarian aid into all areas of Gaza.
Question 5, Richard Lennon.
To ask the Scottish Government further to the vote on motion S6M11342 on the situation in the Middle East on the 21st of November, whether it will provide an update on what action it has taken with the UK Government and international bodies to support the humanitarian response.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has been in continuous discussion with the UK Government on this matter. We welcome the additional £60 million committed by the UK Government for humanitarian response in Gaza, which Scottish taxpayers have, of course, contributed to. The Scottish Government has committed £750,000 to the United Nations Relief and Works Agency, and on the 2nd of November, the First Minister and I met with the European Director to discuss the dire humanitarian situation in Gaza. Officials have also consulted with various UN agencies and international humanitarian organisations operating under Scotland's Humanitarian Emergency Fund, with whom I will meet with in early January.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Minister for that reply? We are witnessing before our eyes what experts fear to be an unfolding genocide of the Palestinian people. The death toll defies description. Thousands more are still missing under the rubble of over 250,000 destroyed buildings. Nowhere is safe, a population forced to flee to the south of Gaza only to be bombed when they get there. It is unthinkable that we are witnessing this. It is unconscionable that we should be a participant. So we welcome the aid provided by the Scottish Government. But what good is it if we are also providing public funding to arms manufacturers supplying the Israeli government? Will the Scottish Government agree to stop this funding immediately?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, any action taken by Israel must be in accordance with international law. The Geneva Convention must be upheld, including protecting citizens against the consequences of military action, the taking of hostages, indiscriminate bombing of civilian infrastructure, intentional starvation and forced displacement of a population are prohibited under the Geneva Convention. And I would urge all people to get round the table and bring a quick resolution with a ceasefire and humanitarian aid into the areas.
Number of supplementaries. Again, they'll need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Kirkcaldy.
Thank you. We are hearing dire warnings from the UN officials on the ground in Gaza about the scale of the humanitarian disaster unfolding. Does the Minister agree that in order to prevent further deaths, it remains urgent that the international community works together to press for an urgent ceasefire? And can she provide any further update regarding the Scottish Government's latest engagement with the UK Government in regards to this?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I said in an earlier answer, the First Minister wrote to the Prime Minister on the 21st of November calling for the UK to support an immediate ceasefire in Gaza, to ask the International Criminal Court to investigate if war crimes have been committed by both Israel and Hamas, and for the UK to recognise the state of Palestine. A junior Foreign Office Minister replied, restating the UK Government's position in favour of temporary humanitarian pauses. They did not address the First Minister's other two calls. We are gravely concerned by the resumption of hostilities and continue to call for an immediate and permanent ceasefire on both sides and a release of all hostages.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister not think the approach should be the one taken by my colleague Leila Moran, MP in Westminster? She stated that we need a two-state solution. We recently saw a pause in fighting, which shows this is possible. We now need to see it replicated as a basis for the creation of a permanent bilateral ceasefire. Can I ask the Minister to impress upon the UK Government the importance of action to make this a reality?
Minister.
Yeah, happy to impress on the UK Government that position. The Scottish Government supports the EU and the UK Government's positions of a two-state solution based on the 1967 borders and firmly encourages both Israel and Palestine to reach a sustainable negotiated settlement under international law, which has as its foundation mutual recognition and the determination to coexist peacefully. And the recent pause was an example of how they can do that.
Question 3, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact of introducing ticket levy schemes at large music venues in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government fully values the importance of music to Scotland's culture and recognises the role that venues play in supporting the talent pipeline. The Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development met with Music Venue Trust on the 20th of September to discuss the challenges faced by grassroots music venues and their proposal to develop a ticket levy, and I've recommended that the Music Venue Trust ask the Cross-Party Group for Music to convene an industry roundtable to discuss this proposal.
Mark Ruskell.
Well, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that positive response? The Music Venue Trust estimate that a £1 levy on tickets for shows at the two big arenas in Scotland would generate £1 million a year. And, of course, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that AG Entertainment have now announced the plans for a new mega venue at Edinburgh Park, where a £1 levy could raise £8,500 at each sold-out show. So does the government agree that this could really be a significant funding stream where the profits of big culture can be reinvested into grassroots music, arts and cultural venues? And will ministers agree to meet with me in the new year and the Music Venues Trust to discuss a way forward on the back of the conversations that I understand are now taking place?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Mark Ruskell is absolutely right to highlight that new thinking is required about funding culture and the arts. We have gone through a pivot point through the pandemic. There's been a change in social behaviours, and there's been extreme distress in the arts and cultural sector, which we acknowledge, and we have helped to try and support through this difficult period. So yes, one needs to look with great seriousness at the potential for additional and parallel funding streams, and that's why I think this is one proposal that is worthy of further consideration and is something that should be looked at more closely.
Supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Grassroots music venues are key to supporting emerging Scottish talent, and it's vitally important that they get that support. However, in Scotland this year, 22% of grassroots music venues have either closed or are in crisis. What recent conversations has the Cabinet Secretary had with grassroots music venues about their concerns for the support of the sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
So not only is this something that has already been the subject of discussions that my colleague held in September with the Music Venue Trust, but she also met with John Whittingtail to discuss this very issue. It should be of concern to absolutely everybody if the number of venues right across the country reduces. It's something that Creative Scotland is very seized in. It is something that our enterprise agencies that have responsibility in the Highlands and Islands for the rest of Scotland, the Borders, I think are also very involved in. If Mr. Stewart has any particular insights or he has any particular proposals to make, I'd be very happy to listen to them.
Question 4, Colette Stevenson.
To ask the Scottish Government when the Constitution Secretary last met the UK Government and what was discussed.
Cabinet Secretary.
My last meeting with a representative of the UK Government was with the British Ambassador to China in Beijing on the 23rd of November. During my visit to China, which included promotional events in and around St. Andrew's Day, multiple events involving Scottish Government ministers and officials took place in China, the United States, Canada, Germany, France, Oslo, Brussels and London, thanks to everybody who was involved, although I think it's worth noting that Irish ministers managed to attend St. Patrick's Day events in 36 locations around the world.
Colette Stevenson.
Presiding Officer, the Westminster Government's autumn statement offered little to help people worried about making it through the winter. There was no energy bill rebate, no action to reduce grocery bills, and nothing to tackle growing poverty and destitution. In contrast, this morning the Scottish Government published its blueprint for social security in an independent Scotland, which includes plans for a minimum income guarantee, scrapping the rate clause and creating a more dynamic economy. It is clear that people in Scotland are suffering from the cost of living crisis, but does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it's time for us to escape the cost of Westminster crisis so that we can build a fairer, independent Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree wholeheartedly with the member. It's clearer than ever that independence is essential to build a fairer and wealthier country and escape the failed Brexit-based Westminster economic model, which has given us the largest fall in living standards on record and the highest inflation in the G7, as well as high levels of inequality and poverty. Our latest publication, Social Security in an Independent Scotland, sets out how independence would enable Scotland to take a new approach to social security designed to tackle poverty and build financial security.
Supplementary first, Donald Cameron.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned the paper Social Security in an Independent Scotland. However, at the same time, this government has already missed its deadline of transferring new devolved powers to Social Security Scotland by 2020, and earlier this year announced a further three-year delay to the transfer, now due in 2026, a full decade after the Scotland Act 2016. So, Cabinet Secretary, is the Scottish Government still on track for the 2026 date?
Cabinet Secretary.
In his question, Donald Cameron, of course, missed out the Scottish Child Payment, which has been widely applauded, not just in Scotland, but Firth of Scotland, as an extremely significant intervention which is helping lift thousands of children out of poverty. Of course, with a significant administrative change, there will always be challenges, and I'd be happy to get my ministerial colleague responsible for the agency to write to him to give him further details. But I think it would be churlish to not acknowledge the significant advantages that have been brought by Scotland having not the most significant, but a significant impact in terms of social security. It's one, incidentally, that the United Kingdom is not prepared to match.
And Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Both the Scottish and UK governments will be aware of the importance of language degrees in securing international cooperation, understanding and trade. The issue of cuts to modern languages at Aberdeen University has been raised with me by both the French and German consulates. What discussions has the Cabinet Secretary had with the UK Government, the Education Secretary and consulates regarding this matter? And does he agree with me that these cuts would be a retrograde step, not just for students, but for Scotland as a whole?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I hear very much what Neil Bibby has to say. I would firstly say that, of course, our universities are autonomous of government. That's a statement of fact. I have noted very carefully the points that have been made by the Consuls General who have written to Aberdeen University, which is where I was very proud to study. And I've also noted the intervention of Miguel Berger, the German ambassador to the UK on the issue of language teaching. He will appreciate that language teaching and learning is something very close to my heart, being somebody who speaks two languages and speaks another language to my own children, which is not English. I understand the value of languages, and we should be extremely seized of making sure that we do everything that we can to provide the appropriate level of teaching right through our school system and our university system, and it's something that is the subject of discussion between myself and ministerial colleagues, and we'll be happy to raise with UK government representatives, which I think was the question that was posed originally. Originally, if there are lessons to be learnt from elsewhere in the UK, I'd be quite happy to look at those, although I would observe that the
question
challenge,
six, Rose McCall.
The challenges throughout the Anglosphere.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the reopening of sites that are currently closed due to inspections by Historic Environment Scotland.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Historic Environment Scotland is making good progress on its inspection programme, which is due to conclude at the end of March next year. Of the 70 sites that had access restricted due to high-level masonry issues, there is now full or partial access to 53 of those sites, and details of the inspection programme and site reopenings are published on the Historic Environment Scotland website. I'm pleased that Historic Environment Scotland continues to put the health and safety of individuals first, reopening sites when it's only safe to do so.
Rose McCall.
I thank the Minister for that response. She may be aware of the situation at Ravenscraig Castle in Kirkcaldy, which has been closed for a significant period due to inspections carried out by Historic Environment Scotland. These inspections revealed safety concerns relating to the bridge. Unfortunately, I've been made aware of a number of continued incidents of antisocial behaviour at the site, with youth scaling the walls and causing further damage, in some cases throwing stonework from the roof. The preservation of our historic buildings is a crucial part of our cultural inheritance. So can I ask the Minister what more can be done to protect buildings currently closed by Historic Environment Scotland?
Minister.
Yeah, President Officer, I'm very concerned to hear about the antisocial behaviour issue, and I will take that up with colleagues after question time today. But I am pleased to confirm there is now full or partial access to a number of sites in the member's region, and I'm also pleased to confirm that Historic Environment Scotland would be happy to offer the member a visit to any of the sites affected by access restrictions in her region and to discuss matters with our Historic Environment Scotland expert. I would urge Ros McCall to take up that opportunity, but on the antisocial behaviour issue on the particular site she mentions, I will take that forward straight after question time. Thank you.
Question 7, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what it's doing to support the arts and culture sector in Glasgow.
Cabinet Secretary.
And the Scottish Government, through Creative Scotland, provides support to a number of cultural organisations in Scotland. In 2021-22, Creative Scotland awarded £23,629,887 through its regular open and targeted funding to successful applicants from individuals and organisations based in the Glasgow area. Glasgow is, of course, in addition, home to the national performing companies, namely the National Theatre of Scotland, Scottish Ballet, Scottish Opera and the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and of course celebrate all of the institutions that he himself has just listed for the work they do here. Arts and culture, as you know, have been part of Glasgow's heritage for decades, but for years now, threats and in some cases cuts to the sector have made jobs ever more precarious. So can I ask Cabinet Secretary, what plans are in place to bring security to the sector and ensure that Glasgow's share of the funding promised is invested in good quality, unionised jobs in Glasgow?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I hope Pam Duncan-Glancy would agree with me that the organisations funded through Creative Scotland do exactly that, as do our national performing companies, as does the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland. I'd also draw her attention to the latest funding round through the Youth Music Initiative Formula Fund, where Glasgow City Council received support of £544 to offer music tuition in schools across the city. This includes organisations such as the National Piping Centre, Music Broth, NIOS and AC Projects. All of them receive funding. All of them, I would hope she would agree, provide tremendous additional benefit to the arts and cultural scene in Glasgow, which is vibrant and deserves the support of everybody, including the public of Glasgow, who I would encourage to attend all cultural and arts events from the organisations that we have been discussing as part of this question session.
Thank you. Supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Thank you, President Officer. Glasgow's world-leading museums are amongst the most frequented in Scotland and are major attractions for international visitors. However, colleagues in the city tell me that unlike Edinburgh or Dundee's major museums, Glasgow's museums do not enjoy national status and therefore do not attract commensurate funding from the Scottish Government. Can I ask what the Minister is doing to address this imbalance?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, these issues are constantly under review. I would point out from my earlier answer that we have a list of national performing companies that are based in Glasgow and not elsewhere in Scotland. So there is a mixed picture of how culture and the arts is funded, which organisations are based where. We need to make sure that there is coverage throughout Scotland, that there is equity. But I think he's absolutely right to draw attention to the fact that the museums in Glasgow are not just first class, they are world class. And they deserve the support of people in Glasgow. I know they are already. And for those of us in the rest of Scotland looking for a great day out, I would encourage them to visit Glasgow's museums as well.
Thank you. And question 8, Claire Hawkey.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to promote and support cultural activities in the Rutherglen constituency.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government values the arts and recognises the contribution that cultural activities make to wellbeing, the economy and nurturing creative expression, not only in Rutherglen, but to all communities across Scotland. Between the 1st of April 2020 and the 31st of October 2023, Creative Scotland made 227 awards, totalling £856,000 to applicants whose postcodes were in the Rutherglen Scottish Parliamentary constituency. This funding was awarded through Creative Scotland's Open Fund, targeted funding and also through emergency COVID-19 funding.
Claire Hawkey.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Royal Borough of Rutherglen celebrates its 900th anniversary of being granted the title by King David I of Scotland in 1126 in just over 2 years' time. Plans are well underway to celebrate this anniversary with local organisations, charities and elected members, amongst others, coming together to arrange events throughout 2026. Can the Minister advise what the Scottish Government can do to support and promote what will be a community cultural event, the scale of which has likely not been seen in my constituency before?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the upcoming anniversary for Rutherglen is an extraordinary symbol of the endurance of the borough. For celebrations such as this in Rutherglen, organisations and individuals can apply to Creative Scotland's Open Fund and the National Lottery Award for All to seek support for this event. Creative Scotland may also provide further advice regarding applications and other potential funding opportunities by contacting their inquiries service. And can I wish my constituency neighbours in Rutherglen all the best in celebrating such a historic milestone? Yeah.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next portfolio to allow front benches to change. Okay, in the next portfolio is Justice and Home Affairs. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Sandesh Gulhani.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taking to ensure that all fire and rescue officers in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service have access to decontamination facilities.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The safety and well-being of firefighters is a priority to both the Scottish Government and the Fire Service. The Scottish Fire and Rescue Service continues to make progress through its dedicated contaminants group. It has reviewed processes and procedures to ensure the risk of contamination has been minimised. This includes a review of all fire stations to ensure they have site-specific control measures to minimise contamination.
Sandesh Gulhani.
It's clearly not a priority to the Scottish Government because a bombshell report found that firefighters are almost twice as likely than the general public to die of cancer. And those serving longer in the fire service increase their risk of cancer and they suffer from higher mental health issues. And this is all due to exposure to contaminants and toxins and re-exposure when they have contaminated kit and equipment. And just like during COVID, when this SNP government said to cut the bottom of doors off, they are asking firefighters to use wipes on their equipment. This is a danger to our brave firefighters. So, Minister, why has your government failed for years to give the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service the budget it needs to invest in proper decontamination equipment that actually will save their lives?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Fire Rescue Service is working closely with the FBU and the University of Central Lancashire and is taking action across all aspects of operations to reduce exposure to contaminants, including investment in new fire appliances and facilities. I will continue to work closely with both Scottish Fire Rescue Service and the FBU on this important matter, and I will carefully consider any proposals coming forward which would increase the safety and well-being of firefighters.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Audrey Nicholl.
The Scottish Government's commitment to the safety and well-being of all Fire and Rescue Service officers is very welcome. With that said, the recent UK Government Autumn Statement failed to take the necessary action needed to increase investment in vital services such as SFRS. So with limited levers available to Scotland to increase our spending power, can the Minister outline the impact of the disappointing Autumn Statement on responding to the real challenges facing these services moving forward?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Autumn Statement delivered the worst-case scenario for Scotland's finances. The funding provided falls far short of what we needed and makes the challenges for our budget next year even more severe. The Chancellor has failed to provide the funding needed, with little consideration on the specific challenges that we face, letting Scotland down on every count. Scotland needed more money for infrastructure, public services, fair pay deals. Instead, he delivered a real terms reduction in the total block grant. The Chancellor chose to make an indiscriminate cut to national insurance while depriving public services of vital funding. This shows a UK government has the wrong priorities at the wrong time.
Katie Clark.
In the recent Firestorm report, over 90% of firefighters said they were concerned about the impact of contaminants on their health, with firefighters saying they had inadequate changes of uniform, laundry facilities and showering facilities to decontaminate. And as Sandeesh Gulhani says, they have to rely on baby wipes to try to clean themselves after being exposed to a fire for hours. Does the Scottish Government think that this is acceptable?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Fire Rescue Service is considering the Fire Brigade Union Firestorm report and, where appropriate, will work with the FBU and other staff representative bodies to address the issues that have been raised. The Cabinet Secretary and myself did meet with the FBU, I think, the week before last, and the Scottish Government will work closely with the SFRS to identify budgetary requirements for 24 to 25.
Question two, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support is available for people in contact with the justice system who may be dealing with vulnerabilities such as mental health issues, problematic substance abuse or homelessness.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, supporting people in contact with the justice system and ensuring effective access to health, housing and other support services is absolutely vital and requires a holistic multi-agency approach, as well as a focus on interventions which can facilitate those links. That's why we are continuing to invest around £134 million per year in community justice services, including community sentences, through care support and other interventions, enabling access to services to access the underlying causes of offending.
Claire Adamson.
I thank the Minister for that, her answer. Distress Brief Intervention, an initiative that was successfully piloted in Lanarkshire, provides quick and compassionate support to people experiencing distress. How will the Scottish Government ensure that DBI services are integrated into communities and ensure that Police Scotland and other public bodies are trained to direct people to distress brief intervention where it might be appropriate?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Police Scotland have been key national partners in the development and implementation of the DBI programme. Frontline staff in Police Scotland, along with their counterparts in the Scottish Ambulance Service, Accident and Emergency, Primary Care and NHS 24, are provided with bespoke DBI training to enable them to assess whether or not a person presenting in distress is appropriate for an offer of referral to DBI support. DBI training continues to be rolled out to staff in these services. DBI is now live in 24 of the 31 health and social care partnership areas, with discussions underway with the remaining areas with a view to being DBI live by the end of March next year. In addition, National Pathway to DBI exists via NHS 24 and via National Call Handling Services operated by Police Scotland and the Scottish Ambulance Service.
Question three, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is regarding the maximum time that a family should be expected to wait for a post-mortem report following the death of a loved one.
Lord Advocate.
The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service is committed to providing bereaved families with final confirmation of the cause of death of a loved one as soon as that information is available. In relation to deaths which require further investigation, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service aims to conduct and conclude the investigation and advise the nearest relative of the outcome within 12 weeks of receipt of the death report in 80% of cases. Some investigations do take longer to establish a final cause of death because of the circumstances of the fatality and the nature of the test required to allow the pathologist to make a final determination. Where that is the situation, nearest relatives are provided with updates on progress and estimated timescales for the completion of the tests.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Lord Advocate for that answer, but of course families are not always provided with the regular updates nor timescales. Does she agree that waiting more than 7 months for a post-mortem report is completely unacceptable? And if so, how many families in Scotland have waited 7 months or more? And after such a time, is it appropriate to tell a family that is a matter, and I quote, we are currently considering and in which we hope to reach a decision shortly?
Lord Advocate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If Mr. Gibson has a particular case and a particular circumstances that he wished to bring to my attention for me to comment on that, I'm more than happy to do that. And I would invite him to make contact with my office and request a meeting with me individually. I would be pleased to do so. I would say, in relation to the factors that may cause a delay in a cause of death being established, that very much depends on the circumstances surrounding a death. The pathologist who has conducted the post-mortem examination may require a number of further investigations to be completed, including further toxicological analysis, as well as an input from, for example, other experts in the fields of neuropathology or histopathology. And the findings of all those inquiries must then be carefully considered before a cause of death can be confirmed. In a small number of cases where those further investigations cannot be progressed in Scotland, specialist facilities elsewhere may require to be approached to assist, and this may result in a delay in the final cause of death being established.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Russell Finn.
Thank you, President Officer. An HM Inspectorate of Prosecution report is highly critical of pathology services in Scotland, while the chair of the Deaths in Prison Custody Action Group says that only the Crown Office thinks that fatal accident inquiry system is effective. Now, many families have told me they've got no faith in how the deaths of loved ones are investigated, yet the SNP government is complacent. So will the Lord Advocate therefore consider families' calls to transfer these vital functions to a new body which will be transparent, accountable and independent of the Crown Office?
Lord Advocate.
Presiding Officer, the issue raised by Mr. Russell obviously relates to fatal accident inquiries, and that is a separate and distinct issue from the one that I'm being asked to respond to today. His question also raised issues about the quality of the pathology service in Scotland, and I can respond to that by explaining that the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service is the client and the recipient of forensic pathology services in Scotland to allow Procurator Fiscals to discharge their death investigation duties on behalf of the Lord Advocate. And the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service would support any improvements to the death investigation process that would minimise the distress caused to families without affecting the thoroughness of the investigation, including the confirmation of a cause of death.
Thank you. Just before calling the next supplementary, I'm aware that there are issues with the microphones, including my own by the looks of things, but on the front benches. I'm aware that broadcast are looking at this. It's not affecting broadcasting, but it's clearly not helping in terms of the audio in the chamber. But it is being investigated, and I propose just to continue for the time being. Supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Post-mortem scanners have been trialled in Lancashire and have been reported to decrease the time taken for post-mortem result in certain cases, the need for an invasive post-mortem and removal of organ. Can the Lord Advocate advise what discussion the Scottish Government has had with the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service regarding the potential time-saving qualities of post-mortem scanners in Scotland?
Lord Advocate.
Yes. Thank you, Presiding Officer. The specific issue raised by this point, I'm not in a position to respond to. But there has been a significant efforts made by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and the Scottish Police Authorities and pathologists to reduce the time taken to provide final reports to families and also to consider the wider concept of improvements to the way in which pathology services are delivered. Crown Office regularly meets with the current pathology providers to discuss and seek to help to resolve any ongoing issues and to identify any improvements to the quality of a service that can be provided for nearest relatives. The Crown Office has a series of contracts and service level agreements with universities, local authorities and the NHS for pathology, mortuary and toxicology services across Scotland. The current pathology contract extensions are in the main in place until the end of March 2024, and work is ongoing with all pathology providers on a service redesign to streamline the nature and number of the contracts to ensure resilience and efficiency through negotiation and service co-design. So there's an identification of need for improvement, but in relation to the issue of scanners, I can provide further information on that specific issue after today.
Thank you. Question 4 has been withdrawn. Question 5 was not lodged. Question 6, Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what work it is doing with the Scottish Prison Service to provide inmates, including those on remand, with vocational skills to help them secure employment when they leave prison and help address Scotland's skills challenges.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Prison Service provide a range of vocational skills and qualifications that support personal development and help with securing employment on release for individuals in custody. In addition, contracted services providers, including third sector and statutory providers, support people in areas such as CV writing and interview skills. Through working with stakeholders, the Prison Service is also seeking to understand the skills gaps currently faced by various employment markets by gaining an understanding of the needs of these areas. The Prison Service is seeking to address these shortages by establishing working relationships between employers and prisons across Scotland.
Ivan McKee.
Secretary for that answer, I'm sure she'll agree as Scotland's economy and businesses continue to suffer from skills shortages, we should take every opportunity to meet this need and to support individuals in the criminal justice system to reduce reoffending. Companies and organisations I speak to, including AIME and the Construction Industry Training Board and others, are keen to support in this regard. So can I ask what the Scottish Government is doing working with the SPS to enable businesses to provide training leading to employment opportunities to suitable inmates in advance of their release?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Prison Service regularly engages with national and local organisations in order to provide opportunities for skill enhancement. Examples of this include Robertson's Construction at HMP Perth, which enables engagement and a bespoke training package focusing on the skills required within the construction industry. And today, Green King have also launched a training kitchen at HMP Grampian, which provides bespoke training packages to work in an industrial kitchen, leading to interview and potential employment on release. And SPS also hosts national events to local organisations and employers that are open to employing people with convictions. The most recent event held at HMP Lomas focused on the hospitality sector.
And supplementary, Polly McNeill.
Pullman Young Offenders Institution education participation is obviously a really vital aspect of being in prison. There had been a recent inspection report that said that it's, however, not sufficient participation of young offenders because we're spending too long in their cells. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure me that whatever education and training is offered is relevant? And is she able to get back to me on the question of whether she's satisfied that enough young people are participating in education and training at Portman Young Offenders Institution?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I will of course write to Ms McNeill with further detail. As you would expect, I have looked at the inspector's report closely. I know that Ms McNeill is aware of the value of purposeful activity. There are, of course, some issues with that in and around if someone has been convicted or not. There would be certain offence behaviour programmes that would not be appropriate until someone is convicted, and the prison rules are a little bit different in terms of remand and sentenced prisoners. But nonetheless, the point she makes about the importance of purposeful and, in particular, educational activity is well made.
And briefly, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Dick Stewart is a tremendous organisation in Denniston that provides a halfway between prison and general society for men due to be released from prisons across the Central Belt. It's a key tool in stopping that reoffending cycle. Similarly, Turning Point 218 on Bath Street in Glasgow provides an equally essential service supporting female offenders with complex needs. Yet funding cuts now mean that both of these services are likely to be closed. Surely the Minister agrees that this is a false economy. What is she doing to help sustain these services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm well acquainted with both services that Mr Sweeney narrates. Could I just stress that any cuts most certainly are not my cuts. Decisions about the provision and commissioning of individual community justice services are, of course, taken at a local level. And if I can reassure him that this government continues to invest £134 million in community justice services, that is ring-fenced, as is the £123 million to local authorities. And can I also state that I have not asked any local authority to reduce any specific funding within that.
Question 7, James Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the SFA and SPFL regarding the recent upsurge in the use of pyrotechnics within football stadia.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has been engaging regularly with the SFA and the SPFL for some time about our shared concerns over the misuse of pyrotechnics in football. Most recently, I met with the SPFL and SFA and Football Safety Officers Association Scotland last week on the 30th of November, where we agreed on the need for a multi-agency approach to tackle this issue. And I look forward to working with the football and other key partners to develop this approach in coming weeks.
James Dornan.
I thank the Minister for that response and for the positive response that it was. But isn't it the truth that to date, neither the football authorities, the police, nor the clubs themselves have been willing to take the required action to combat the illegal use of these extremely dangerous fireworks? And given the unwillingness for strong action to be taken and the lack of political will within football for the, in my view, strongly overdue introduction of some kind of strict liability, will the Scottish Government commit to taking seriously the introduction of a Minister for Football, such as been introduced for English football by the Westminster Government, to tackle both the issue of pyros and many of the other antisocial and illegal behaviours regularly seen at Scottish football clubs?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. However, our preferred solution has always been that the footballing authorities themselves are proactively involved in delivering a robust and lasting solution to tackle any unacceptable conduct by what is a minority of people. As I said to Mr. Dorn, and from my recent discussions with those involved, I know that there is a collective will to try and tackle this. And as I've already indicated, we will be taking forward a multi-agency approach to tackle this issue. And I look forward to working with our partners on this. And I know that Police Scotland will continue to engage the SFA and SPFL in regard to the new fireworks legislation and ongoing issues at individual fixtures.
Question 8, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is working with Police Scotland and criminal justice stakeholders to prevent criminal gangs from using so-called county lines for illegal business activities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, county lines and the exploitation of children and vulnerable adults involved is a significant concern for the Scottish Government. Partners on the Serious Organised Crime Task Force, which I chair, continue to use every means at its disposal to disrupt serious organised crime, including county lines activity, and also to raise awareness of the serious harm it causes to individuals, including young people and our communities. The Serious Organised Crime Task Force Progress Report, which was published last week, details some of the work ongoing, including projects such as the Action for Children Early Intervention Service and the County Lines Intensification Week that was undertaken by Police Scotland.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. According to the Scottish Crime Campus 2022 Multi-Agency Strategic Threat Assessment, the north of Scotland is disproportionately impacted by county lines, with three quarters of county lines active across Aberdeen City, Aberdeenshire and Moray. During a recent National County Lines Intensification Week, officers safeguarded 17 young vulnerable people and engaged with 650 others. So can the Cabinet Secretary outline what action the Scottish Government is taking to ensure a whole system multi-agency approach is being taken to identify and safeguard vulnerable young people from further exploitation, in particular the North East, where county lines activity is particularly prevalent?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the safety of our young people who are being exploited by organised crime is of course paramount, and child protection procedures must be activated immediately where there are concerns. And we have published guidance for practitioners on behalf of the Serious Organised Crime Task Force earlier this year. And the guidance helps practitioners identify those at risk from being exploited by serious organised crime groups, including those at risk of involvement in county lines or cuckooing, and what they should do to keep young people safe. Police Scotland in the North East have instigated Operation Protector to address issues associated with serious organised crime, including exploitation and county lines. And we have also provided funding through the Small Community Grant Scheme to the drug harm charity Daniel Spargo Mabs Foundation to deliver inputs and interactive theatre activity discussing drug harms to pupils at 9 secondary schools across Aberdeen City, Aberdeenshire and Moray, and there have been 150 participants to date.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on Justice and Home Affairs. Can I thank members for their patience and perseverance due to the earlier problems with the microphones? And there will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.